question to these people here. Okay, if you have to shut your eyes, and you can shut your eyes now, and think about the top IT companies that you can think about, or the top of mind recall for IT companies, what names comes into your mind? IBM, okay? Microsoft, okay? Infosys. अरे यार पूरा आंसर इधर लिखा हुआ है फिर भी किसी ने पढ़ा नहीं The beauty of this session, and I'd really like to thank NASSCOM, is for the kind of people that that NASSCOM has helped in bringing together onto this. It's not the easiest of things to get all the biggies to come in and sit in this one single dais, and I'd like to thank NASSCOM for the amount of work that they have done here, and I'd also like to thank each one of you for taking time to listen to what's going to happen here. Okay, I know that quite a few ran away, and I can tell you on this panel that people have run away not because they don't want to listen to you. Some of them have got daunted by you, because they thought that agar itne sare technology company aa gaye, so what happens to us? And I'm sure that some of them ran away. Those of you who are not chicken are in this room. So thank you for staying back and showing that you are brave. It takes a sense of bravery to be able to listen to the doyens of technology companies here. The topic that we have is quite interesting. It's about the future. And the idea is to try and bring in what's going to happen in the future, and how is our industry getting redefined, and whether we are in readiness for what's going to happen, or are we going to fall by the wayside. And I think since yesterday, when we talked to various retailers, since we've been speaking to members, that's something that's come up quite live in our minds. So so the question that I'd like to pose to this panel, and they hopefully each one of you can answer this one after the other, is about what are you seeing the future of technology in this world? And you could also combine it with another question: what do you think, therefore, is the future for retailers? What do they need to do from a strategic perspective? So if each one of you can take the 2-3 minutes, or at the most maybe 2 minutes, just 2 minutes, to tell what do you see as the big picture? What is changing in technology? And what do retailers have to do?
Sure. So what we are seeing globally is that retailers are on different stages of their journey to either compete or evolve themselves with the new reality. That we did a survey around 2 years back where we looked at the sectors that are getting most disrupted by technology. And retail is way high up there after telecom, because the consumer experiences are, and the rise of e-commerce in such a big way, is this is one vertical or industry that is getting disrupted day in, day out, right? And now with companies which were predominantly online coming to offline, the battle is in their back door, in the backyard of the offline retailers, right? And the strength that an online company, natively digital company, brings is technology. While retailers have always looked at technology as an enabler, right? So an Amazon or a Flipkart does not look itself as a retail company, but a technology company which does retail, right? And retailers have always looked at IT as a technology, as a support function. Now what is happening is you are grappling with competition which is very, very aggressive to capture land share, and also very fast at innovating. So retailers are having to relook at their models, and also how I can use the same inventory in a way where it can serve more stores, more channels, more consumers. So from what I've encountered in India, retailers so far have been, you know, trying to set up their enterprise systems to be able to get the data together. And the next battle is, how do I optimize my store experience? How do I understand the consumer better? Because the focus so far has been on, get the data, do I even have the data, get the analysis of post-purchase. But if you look at a lot of analytics and recommendations online, happen because everything that you do online before your purchase is analyzed to the last single click that you make. Can I capture a lot more of data in the store when a consumer comes in? Can I identify him when he comes in? and, you know, personalize his experience. We're not saying that, you know, human intervention will go away, but can I enable a store associate to be able to handle an SKU size of 50,000 products better? And because a customer, when he comes in after doing his research online, maybe he's more educated about your own product range than your sales associate. So how do I enable technology, use technology to enable my sales associates better? How do I manage store operations better or monitor retail operations better using IoT, using artificial intelligence? And how do I leverage the, start collecting more and more data and then try to make sense of what the data is showing to me?
Interesting. So I think the key focus there is that the retailers are not going to be competing with retailers. They are going to compete with technology players. And it's a very different kind of a landscape that we are talking about. Prashobh, what's your thought?
Yeah. So Kumar, let me take your second question first. In terms of what should be the strategic focus of the retailers going forward? You know, the single answer is that customer experience. And let's try to address this through the lens of statistics. No matter what the noise that is there in the market, in terms of whether the brick versus clay, 95% of the sales happens in the stores. So, you know, the stores remain as the heart of the retail. But 80% of the people believe that the store experience is underwhelming. Now, this is a very important point for from a factor of that. Brace ahead for, like, what are the biggest disruption that is coming on the way for the Indian retailers. And that is going to be the demographic shift. By 2020, the average age of the country is going to be 28. And we are going to be the youngest nation in the world. We have 500 millennials. They would enter the mainstream by 2020. Statistically, that is more than the combined market share or market size of US, UK, and Australia put together. Now, these are the guys, they would wake up every morning with a Facebook and Flipkart, and they expect a superior customer experience all the time. They are opinionated, they are ruthless. Now, if you don't service to their requirement in your stores, they seldom don't come back. So I think customer experience remains as one of the biggest challenges for the retailers going forward. The second about, like, what technology which is going to dominate, I think what we believe that AI and data is going to dominate the retailing going forward. And one of the biggest adoption of the AI, what we are seeing today, is from the fashion business. And that is a bit of a surprise. The reason is that just on 7th of January, when the H&M CEO mentioned that he has a problem on hand, he said he got 4.3 billion unsold stock on his stores. And his stock actually kind of like nosedived, which is trading at 15-year low today. So that is the case with, I think, most of the fashion retailers. Because I think the design team primarily, like, just look at, you know, their design part of it, like a T-10, and they would primarily, like, subscribe to WGCN, and they would look at what color, what shade, what color would dominate the next season. But 50% of those products actually sell it on the full price sell-through, and rest goes down to the markdown. 20% of those things are actually unsold. Now, if that was any kind of forecast, how different it is from a flip of a coin? And I think now the fashion retailers are adopting AI, trying to see why a particular color, collar, or the fabric didn't sell. And they were trying to look at, like, what were the social chat at that point in time. They were trying to incorporate that right in the product beginning now to see that, you know, the unsold inventory on the stores are reduced, and their markdown is also reduced. Full price sell-through, or the MRP, is going up. So AI seems to be, like, hitting everywhere, including the fashion.
Okay, so that's quite a bit of technology from the point of view of what the retailers need to do. And I think it's all about customer story experience. Okay, so Samik, what's...
Sure. I think, let me take your first question first. What are the trends in technology? And I would categorize them as five trends. Three of them exist today, and we have been talking about. Two of them are in the horizon. I think the three well-known ones are cloud, mobility, and the Internet of Things. They have been existing, and we have been talking about them. The two of them which are in the horizon, one is artificial intelligence and machine learning, and the other one is mixed reality or cognitive reality, augmented reality. It's the combination of these five technology trends to create a smart store or an intelligent store, which actually answers back your question of how do you make the store experience more enriching. So that's from a technology perspective. From a strategy perspective, I think the future is about how do you bring your products, your people, and the customers in alignment with data and intelligence as the core of it. So just visualize it as a Venn diagram. One circle is product, the other circle is customer, the third circle is your own people, and the center of it, which overlaps everything, is intelligence. Now, this looks very simple, but let's look at reality. It's been about 25 years that people have been talking about CRM. You know, if you go back, 25 years ago, a company called Pepper and Rogers had invented this term. 25 years later, we are still struggling with a single view of the customer. We can't even get that, and the customer information is in silos. We are talking about having product, your people, and customer all aligned, and you know, a digital loop flowing through each one of them. And I think that's going to be the future from a strategy. And how do you bring those five pillars of technology to implement this strategy?
Very interesting. I think when you touched upon it, but the fact is that many retailers are grappling with all the three parts of this moving angles. We always say the retail business is about people, the product, and then the ability to create the right kind of space for them. And there is always this worry whether they really have accounted for everybody. I hope they at least have accounted for the internal customers. Some retailers don't even seem to have that in grip when they become very large. And then the products, of course, every time they have to go online, and I've spoken to quite a lot of our retailers, they're getting worried because they're thinking, yaar, mujhe pata nahi hai whether the stocks that I'm showing on my system is the real stocks that I have. Is that right? And then you're talking about a third angle there. So I think it's getting to become tougher, but there should be a single view because the third angle is the customer angle, and that's the more important angle. If you know who the customer is and if you are in dialogue with that customer, the rest of it can be placed. I think sometimes that's where things are getting not prioritized well. If you know your customer, even if you say that I've got the stock, if you don't have the stock, you can make good that particular promise by bringing in stock from elsewhere. But if you don't know who is your customer and what he wants, I don't think you can do anything anyway. So that's quite a nice angle that you brought up. What's the thought that you have?
Some of the technology aspect anyway, Samik touched upon. See, multiple things are going to happen. Our retailers are still on a technology which is probably a couple of generations behind. So there's a whole lot of tech refresh which is needed. And associated to that tech refresh, there's a reskilling which is needed. Big time reskilling needs to happen for the people. Their own people as well as the customers. And customers are doing that, their own behavior is changing. If you look at traditionally as a country, we were always touch and feel. We'll not buy anything unless I can touch it with my own hand and get a feel of it. But that is changing. I mean, as the younger lot is preferring more to buy online and all. So in short term, that is going to happen. Tech refresh needs to happen. Reskilling needs to happen. In a long term, the way we believe, a lot of these shiny shops are going to become warehouses. Okay, as the AR, VR matures, these shiny shops are not needed. I mean, because you're just going to get into the VR, get the feel of it, and just order that stuff. And that needs to get delivered to your doorstep, or you go and pick up. So those shiny shops are going to go away. I mean, they'll become large warehouses supported by supply chain. So that's another area where we need to prepare ourselves. I mean, that's what we believe in. I mean, these two things is going to happen, play out in future.
Thank you very much. Rahul, what's...
See, from our perspective, the way we see the market growing and the trends, we can actually club them under three trends. So one is reimagining the complete shopping experience. So when we talked about the in-store experience, the personalization part, that has become going to become more important. And worldwide, we have seen a lot of retailers actually get into personalization, but quite frankly, has it delivered the results? Have they reached where they wanted to reach? No, it's not. So there's going to be a lot more focus on personalization, the single view of customer across the channels that you're operating in. The second is digitizing the retail. So whether it's the in-store experience, in-store technologies like beacon solutions or shelf-based electronic markers, or it is insight-driven analytics. Quite frankly, there's a startling data of the research which was done, in which what came out was that only 16% of retail organizations believe that their data, which they are getting from their predictive analytic tools, is actually something that they can depend on. So there's a lot more work which needs to be done on analytical side to ensure that we can do insight-based marketing and have personalization which can actually really deliver what personalization is supposed to deliver. The third area where we are looking at organization focusing in a large way is driving basically hyper productivity in their retail channel. So implementation of tools like AI, robotics, will play a huge part in order to drive hyper efficiency. One more important point which was made, quite frankly, is that by 2020, more than 40% of the people who will be purchasing will be actually millennials. And there are so many new technologies, and they are the generation which actually wants to try out new technology. So there are so many new technologies which is coming, which is voice-based search. Organizations have to be ready. How will they manage voice-based search? Are the organizations ready to cater to that kind of a requirement? Google is talking about Google Eye. You like something, you take a photograph of that thing from Google Eye camera, and you can immediately go online and buy exactly the same stuff. So are we ready for those technologies which are going to be used by the millennials going down the line? So those are the areas where we think organizations are going to focus on and see how we can make ourselves relevant. And quite frankly, there was a nice line I read which said, retail is not dead, but boring retail is. So we need to focus more and more on customer experience, on virtual, on personalization. And personalization is something which is not static. As the person's income increases, as his buying pattern changes, you need to keep a track of that. It's not a static effort that once you have done personalization for a person A, it will remain static. It will keep on changing his buying habits. His habits will keep on changing. His salary will keep on increasing. His spending will keep on increasing. So we need to keep a track of that throughout the life cycle.
It's quite interesting. In fact, when Kapil, you were talking about the changes, and you kind of mentioned that the e-commerce players are also doing things which is to do with offline, and therefore they are getting there. I don't know how one has to view this. For example, if those channels that's actually accounting for 2 to 15%, depending upon where you are in the world, is trying to get onto the 85% channel, then you might say that that's logical because they're doing something which is only 15%. So they have to get onto the larger part of the business. So is it that they are going there? Or is it the other way around? Is it that the 85% channel are now under threat by the 15% channel? And in India, it is 98% channel by the 2% channel.
I think there are two kinds of companies, one that are born digitally native and the one that are reacting to digital disruption. I think both ways is the moment. The online players, when they come to offline, they will not run offline the way the offline players have been running it. They're very, very data driven. And they have the advantage of starting from a clean slate, right? And the offline players have an advantage of A, having the real estate presence, having a certain brand presence in the market, and having dealt with the trade channel for a long time, right? And the pulse of the consumer. So touch and feel will not go away. But retailers, we believe, are doing two things. One, re-evaluating what can I do in my existing store? What technology interventions can I bring in from a understanding the consumer better, serving him better, enabling my associate better, and in getting a single view of my customer as well as inventory. The other thing that they're trying to do parallelly is, can I start from a clean slate and say, instead of a 50,000 square feet, 100 stores, can I have 5,000 square feet, 1,000 stores? And how do my backend system support such a channel where my inventory now needs to be in so many stores? But maybe I don't need to give, the customer can come to the store, experience, try, but he gets delivered from a dark store or a warehouse. Because if Amazon or Flipkart can deliver same day, next day, from a Bangalore or some other warehouse, why can't my Bhiwandi warehouse not deliver all over Bombay same day, right? So there are learnings that everybody is borrowing from each other.
Yeah, it's actually, that's the dichotomy that many retailers are facing. That whether I should create a showroom and not a shop, which means it's not a storeroom, or do I need to make it a storeroom where instantaneously customer can see it and pick it up and go. So there is this insta understanding in the minds of customer. Because frankly, a customer who comes in wants to have all the fun fare of being able to get the best price, being able to browse across everything, but they also want it then and there. They're not wanting to let go of the timing element in this whole thing. So, and that's something that I'm sure everybody's trying to try and crunch, because if I've decided on something before I change my mind, you want me to be able to enjoy it so that you think that, okay, I've satisfied the customer. So it's quite interesting. Prashobh, when I was speaking to you in Bangalore, you had brought up one topic which I thought was quite interesting. You had told us to, and Rahul in fact touched upon it slightly. You talked about voice-based search. And you were saying that going forward, everything is going to become voice and video. And I was actually expecting you to tell that. Just for the audience sake, we did not talk about what they are going to talk about the future, because I thought that we should not know, nobody should know the answer of this immediately, much before this. So, but I thought that, that kind of kept ringing in my brain, that because of 5G, if everything is going to become voice, everything is going to become video, and words that you normally type has got no more significance, does it change the way retail is?
Yeah, I think two terms which is going to dominate the commerce in India going forward are going to be, one is a conversational commerce, and the second is going to be experiential commerce. So let me explain what is the conversational commerce. Now, when we have 5G, say maybe 1 year or 2 years down the line, 5G technically is 45,000 faster than 4G. And that would actually open up completely a new dimension altogether, wherein whatever we are doing today in terms of typing and texting, that would just move over to voice. So we would have a conversational commerce, and with 5G getting rolled out and Reliance Jio coming in, we would see completely a different commerce experience altogether. The second one is going to be called as experiential commerce. So that means if I have a large store, and if I could just try all these things virtually through my digital platform, then I could just have a better cross-sell and upsell and better market size than in there itself. One of the largest such shop in the Germany was like Globetrotter. But then they have taken a very traditional route, wherein they have this like huge, gigantic shop, wherein you could try almost every product what you want to do physically. But then, by taking this digital route, we could have all these things virtually done in the stores itself. So we are not talking about this to be done online, but it is going to be done in the stores itself. And this is one of the largest like outdoor, the gear manufacturing company in India. They are adopting this particular model. So they are saying that I would like to have my people coming and trying out all these things in my stores itself digitally. So now this is going back to Santosh's point, saying that like we were slightly behind the technology, maybe a generation behind. But on the hindsight, that must be perhaps the best thing to happen, because we would have been perhaps skipped one particular technology layer implementation altogether, because this 4G, 5G coming in and experiential commerce going to dominate going forward, we could perhaps kind of just move into that one without actually worrying too much about a legacy part. So we might see completely a different commerce experience going forward thanks to these technologies.
Yeah, we did have representative from Reliance Retail here, and we were talking about geo effect in this country. It was very clear that we were at some 100 something ranking when it came to the usage of data in the world, and suddenly after geo has come in, we are almost at the top of the ladder. I think it is top already. So it's it doesn't take too much of time for us to go from last bencher to the first bencher. We don't seem to really bother about the middle benches at all. Samir, you were talking about some interesting things that you've seen in the retail industry and some of the trends, and also some humorous stories. So you promised that you're going to tell some humorous things there, examples. So would you like to take that up now?
Sure. I think, let me come back to the three trends I spoke about and then bring them to reality. The first I talked about was the virtual reality, or the mixed reality as we say. The second is the machine learning or artificial intelligence. And the third aspect that we see a lot while people talk about it is cognitive intelligence. That's how do you catch the sentiments of people, okay, automatically. And let me try and put all of this together and give you some examples as well. So augmented reality, and you all would have read about this HoloLens, is when you wear it and you can visualize and try out and touch and feel things without it actually being there. So just imagine, we all go and try to make a modular kitchen today. or we design a wardrobe. And you know, all that we see is the wood and the designs. But imagine just wearing that HoloLens, and you can feel it, you can open it, you can put clothes in it, you can take out clothes from it, you can close the shutter, you can just feel the whole thing, and then you order it. Okay? And that's how the consumer behavior will change. From a retailer perspective, using a lot of intelligence, it will tell the retailer that this guy is going to actually order veneer wood of this kind, of this pace, and of this material, and of this design. So it makes things much, much easier, because you just got back, and a few of my colleagues talk about how do you get all of this back into supply chain? And that's how the intelligence flies back. That's what we called about is the digital loop. And the third aspect of it is understanding the sentiments. So today you have these things, Greg, that you walk into a shop or you walk into a particular place, it can actually understand from cameras what is your age and what's your mood that day. And how do you use that intelligence in your store on shop to have a meaningful dialogue with the person and sell him something? Now, it's not too far away. I don't know how many of you have visited the Hyatt Regency in Bangalore. In Bombay. Anybody? SAARC Airport, Hyatt Regency. Have you gone to the lift? Right? You see there is an advertisement there. Just notice the advertisement next time. It's a very simple advertisement. It's about a person having a conversation in a coffee shop, and he's having a very disturbed conversation. And the bartender or the person in the coffee shop observes him from a distance. And the moment the conversation gets over, this guy comes over and gives him a refreshing drink. It's basically showing the touch. Now that whole thing can actually be done using technology today. And that's what the future is about. And we are seeing this happening there. You know, the thing about you walking in and being able to understand your mood and stuff like that, and sentiments is real. So how do you bring all of this thing together to give that experience to the consumer? And that experience of yours when you're in a bad mood, that experience of yours when you are in a good mood, that experience of yours when you're in a lighter mood are very, very different. It's the same customer, it's the same store, it's the same product. But how do you change that? It's what the future is about.
That's quite interesting. Yesterday, the opening panel, when the NASSCOM presentation was happening, when Devjani talked about the emphasis that she made on the way retail should be and what retailers should always know as the constant. The only constant factor, she said, was about trust. And I think that kind of brought the whole thing into a capsule. Because if you are a retailer and if you are offering whatever you are offering, if you can keep rebuilding on the trust factor, then irrespective of where your technology is, and I think that's where you're coming to about that ability to go back to the customer, give that coffee when they want a coffee, and not give them a cold drink when they want a coffee. Many times even that happens. I think it's a very interesting part, and I think that's it's a very difficult thing. And do you all seriously believe that technology can give that? You talked about that 16%, and I was getting worried. Yaar, ye to sirf 16% hai, baaki kya karenge? 84% got left out of this. Do you believe that technology can help us in being more right with analytics than be wrong because of analytics? Anyone of you can answer, but because that solar 16% was brought up, I ask here.
Though I see the way you have to change, and coming back to the first point that you had asked, I don't think it is the challenge, the fight is between online and retail.
Not
it will more or less the way it will transition will be, it will not be brick or click, it will be brick and click or click and brick, whichever way you, whichever comes first. So analytics will definitely play an important part. Analytics insights basically to decide where is it that you want to put what kind of inventory. If there is, for example, in one more study that was done, I think it was IDC or one of the firms, where they expected people, where the people were expecting was convenience. That means 71% of the people were saying that they want to have an outlook of an inventory in a particular store and then go and pick it there, pick it up from there. So what they are looking at is the power of digital and the touch of retail. So they want the best of both the worlds because they still value the recommendations given to them by the sales person in a particular retail shop or any other organization. So they are looking at both best of both the worlds. Now, for a retailer to be able to deliver that, unless and until they have these insights, they will not know the buying pattern of the people in a particular locality. So today you are sitting here, and you are on your way, or this is your office, and you're on your way, and you want to pick up some stuff. They need to know and personalize to the effect that what are the things that you would like to buy, and can they keep them in the store which are nearest to you, so that you can order them online, go there, pick it up, and go home. So you get that convenience element in. You get the contextual element in, because it's basically three C's: connectivity, convenience, and context. If you get all the three in, you can actually deliver much more value to the customer. And that you can do only if you have the insights. And that can only come if you have the solution implemented. Without this, it will become very difficult.
In fact, one of the people who got the award yesterday was a company called Purple. Anybody from Purple here? And they seem to have built parts of this yesterday. And they've kind of ensured that you can, as you like you spoke about, as you get up from here, and if you have to buy a few things, you can buy from any of the shops nearby. You can go there and pick it up. And more importantly, once you've landed into the shop, if you want to add something more, you can add that. You can do self-checkout. Basically, it's like Amazon Go, but in a much more, what you can call it as, easy format.
Sure.
So,
see,
quite
One more point that the retailers are trying to push, and which is a focus which we are seeing at least in a big way in international geos, is how do you increase the basket size? If somebody is today buying, on an average, a basket size of $1,000, how can you leverage on cross-sell and upsell techniques and ensure that if he is buying, say, a suit, can you push a tie, can you push a shirt, a matching tie, a matching shirt? So artificial intelligence plays a big part. Your analytics plays a big part. So can you increase that basket size from $1,000 to $1,500? That's an incremental sale you are doing just because of the kind of technology that you have implemented. And that is the way organizations are driving. And unless and until all these technologies play a part, you will not be able to reach there.
Yeah, I saw somebody from Raymond here. Anybody from Raymond? Okay, he has to be blamed. Because they came out with a nice scheme. I went there to buy a suit day before yesterday, walked out of the store after spending $66,000. I don't know why I did it even now. So the buyer's remorse is hitting me now. So obviously the store manager and the technology and the made to measure, everything came together to make sure that they've kind of, without thinking and without remorse, I spent that money. So there are things happening in this place very clearly. And Rakesh today was saying that he's looking for 1 crore customers who would spend 1 lakh of rupees with him so that they achieve their 3.0. So I know how things are going in this country. So I've got one more question, and I can see there's 12 minutes left. So I've got a combined question which should be answered by each one of you, and then we'll throw it open to the audience if it's okay. And the question is, now is the time to put the retailers on the mat or to show where you are? So two things. One is that when you talk about technology, there is always this thing about why would a retailer really adopt the technology? Why should they incur the costs? And what is the common things that you are facing with retailers here in India, purely India context? And the second part of that is about what are the common pitfalls that you are seeing with technology adoption with retailers in India. You may not take any names, and I take it that that's the way it has to be. If you want to take names, be brave. But what are the common pitfalls that you see with technology adoption in India? Because we already have told that they will go from last benches to first benches. But obviously, there are still some last benches, and there are still some technology adoption requirements. And because all of you are global companies, you are seeing customers across the world, this becomes very relevant. So it's a combined question. What do you see as the main things that customers look for when you talk to retailers in India, especially when it comes to adoption of technology, costs, or various other things? And after they've adopted, what are the pitfalls?
See, I think one is, like it or not, there's no choice whether you want to adopt technology or not.
Like it or not, how many of you like it? Okay, the others are not, but they have to do it.
No, because if you look at macroeconomically, there was one large market was US, then there was China, and then there is India. And some of the global giants have decided that they might have lost China, but they're not going to lose India, right? So the battle is going to be here, and retail definitely. Modern retail has not really transpired big because of real estate and other issues. So you get a Nike on online today in Jumri Talaya, where Nike may not have a store, right? So that, I think the choice is how much do I spend my effort and bandwidth on running the lights on versus innovating in my retail experience. And I think there are two large pillars. One is customer experience, the other is operational efficiency. Operational efficiency is still geared towards measuring, cost saving, monitoring better. I think retailers are still doing their better. Customer experience, again, is very, very qualitative. And unless linked to a very direct metric of revenue per user and retention per user and profitability per user, can be a very fuzzy logic. And I think that's where it's a more organization-wide coming top-down and not from IT as an initiative, where I think we are seeing a challenge.
Yeah, I think the technology adoption today is extremely important, but I think let's also understand what we are going through as an organization. I mean, to a large extent, we have gone through that retail 1.0, then 2.0, and currently we are going through retail 3.0. In retail 1.0, the operational cost used to be somewhere close to 18 to 20%. And with the retail 2.0, which was predominantly an e-com, I think the expense gone up to 40% or 45%, primarily because like there was like one-day delivery, free trial, so on and so forth. So it remains as like very fancy part, but like not really a good winning proposition from a profit point of view. So hence like the 3.0, what we are going through today, wherein I think most of the enterprises are trying to address the cost part under sub 10%. And you could do that only with like AI, data, and few other technologies. I'm not really talking about ERP, CRM, because I think that is given. Because until and unless we know like who are our buyers and what is the ethnicity breakup of my trade area, there's no way I can improve my trade on, right? Because my stock turn has to be improved. I should know like, who is living and who is buying within my trade area. And if I were to just have to leave my product within my credit days of my vendors, I ideally have to sell my product within the first 30 days. And the more I keep it, then obviously like I'm hitting into my capex. So I think ethnicity breakup and demographic details of the trade area is very important. And you could do that very well by taking the AI and the data. And retail 3.0, I think data would remain as the key part. Kumar, your second question was about what was the pitfalls of the technology adoption. Two things. One is that I think the technology adoption has to be on the bite size. It should not be really a big bang, because you don't want to disrupt your existing business. You may want to just try this in a bite size, and either you fail fast, or you're trying to just templatize that in the larger part of it. But equally important, often what we don't really do is that we don't really link the technology adoption or implementation with a capital employed calculation. Until and unless there is a return of capital employed by the technology adoption, it does not really like make too much of sense. And return of capital employed can be improved either by like improving that my sales and the profitability, because the asset location would be completely like your call. And normally we're trying to take this as a technology route, and I think that's the reason sometimes it fails. If you take it through a business lens, and we're trying to say that, okay, this implementation should fetch me an X percentage on my current return of capital employed, often I think it would succeed.
I'll try to give you a common answer to both the questions. I was thinking about how to give the audience back time. I think the first thing, which is a pitfall as well as something to be thought about, is being myopic versus being a visionary. So what we notice a lot is people talk about all the things that we have spoken about here. You know, people have been talking about omni-channel, people have been talking about multi-channel, people talk about customer satisfaction and all of this. But eventually, they go and pick up something which is very, very small. Probably it is governed by a factor of what is the need of that day. Sometimes it is governed by cost. But what you're trying to do is something big. And eventually, after two steps, you will come back to that same position again. So we have gone through this. We have got a lot of customers in the country, you know. And they look at all of these things and eventually they say, okay, I want to change my POS from being a fixed POS into an MPOS. But changing from a fixed POS to MPOS is not digital transformation. Digital transformation is much, much more than that. It's about having your loyalty there. It's about having your customer there. It's about having your products in there. It's about the ability of the person interfacing with you on the shop to give you exactly the same experience as that person had if he went online. He compares two products. He understands what are the offers. He understands delivery dates. He understands what 10 customers who use that product said. Can I do all of that if I just change my fixed POS to MPOS? No. I might just take away the aisle out there, correct? But somewhere that vision gets lost and you go and buy something small that doesn't fit into the whole scheme of things. And because technology is moving very fast, you're always trying to catch up with things and you come back on the same thing again because that technology went outdated. So to buy a technology or a solution which can fit every piece of the big puzzle is, I think, important. Otherwise, you will get stuck. Which comes back to your fact, is how do you come back to an ROI? You come back to an ROI when you look at an whole time picture. Otherwise, you will buy individual things and you will try to fix all of these things together. It won't work and it will be very expensive. The second aspect of it, which I talk a lot about, is the clarity of thought. What actually are you trying to get to by doing an automation? So for example, it's very simple. People say, oh, I want to put a Salesforce automation so that my sales gets better. How do you measure it? I want to put in customer service to become customers, my customer sat should increase. How do you measure it? And how do you know what's right or wrong? Those are very important aspects. So it's about bridging the gap of reality, your own DNA and culture and technology. And that's very important. You know, everybody talks about social. I many times go and ask the CEO, can you show me a dashboard which is telling me what everybody is telling about you? They don't have it. Then how important is social and how important customer satisfaction for you if the CEO of the company does not have it on his plate, correct? And that bridge is important because otherwise your technology will not take you all the way.
Very interesting.
I think,
need to share it because the time is going to kill us now.
So,
we will come back to you when.
You asked two questions. One is, why should we invest in technology or retailers invest in technology? So, the choice is...
No, it's not about why to invest. It's about how do you justify the investments and what are the pitfalls.
Yeah, okay. So, there are two possibilities. Basic, you don't invest, remain and die, become a Kodak moment. Okay. Or you invest, fail somewhere. Okay. By the time you're done with it, there's something new which has come in. So the idea should be that there should be a very quick turnaround on what is going to be my ROI if I adopt this, and how quickly I can fast fail. I mean, how quickly I get to know whether this is good for me or not. Okay. Traditionally, Indians, we were not really first adopters. I mean, we are laggards. Okay. So there's always some case study somewhere for everything. Someone has already done it. Okay. So how quickly you can learn that experience and see if it is helpful for you. That's one. Second question which you were asking, what are the common pitfalls of the adoption? Yeah. See, the way it is changing, I mean, AR, VR, it's there. It's there for the last few years. In fact, US Army did the AR, VR first thing in 80s, okay? So it's there, but how proven it is? I mean, it's still not proven. You still don't have enough skills to do a quick adoption of AR, VR, see if it suits for you, if it gives you the same feel. And that is for everything. I mean, by the time most of the companies are doing them e-com implementation, there's already a talk of AR, VR. I mean, why do you do e-com? Why can't you directly switch to that and give the same experience to those glasses? Okay.
See, from a justification perspective, I believe it depends on what stage of the life cycle as a retailer you are. If it is a retail organization which is really in an existential threat, it will be more on operational efficiency, slightly easier to manage and justify because ROIs can be easily justified. You can clearly make out what the ROI could be from that in terms of operational efficiency, driving sales, and all those things. The challenge starts coming in when you move to the next stage, which is differentiation, which is not so easily justifiable. You can't just do it on the basis of ROI. You have to have intangibles. How will you differentiate vis-a-vis the other retailers? How will you create that brand experience or your brand experience with a customer? So it becomes slightly tougher. And the toughest part is when you reach the visionary stage, when you have at least attained nirvana, and now you want to go into the future technology. So justification clearly depends on which stage of life cycle you are at. As far as pitfalls are concerned, I think one of the main reasons we have seen implementations failing is because you don't have the buy-in of the end users, and we call it design thinking. Most of the time what happens is some three or four people decide this is the kind of application which might be required, which might be an internal application or which might be a customer-facing application. This is what we think the customer needs, or this is what our end users, this is how our end users should operate. They design the application, they come out with a big bang approach, they launch the application, and then nothing happens. Nobody adopts that language, that thing. So one of the best ways is get the design thinking in, get those people involved in the complete process of when you are designing the complete process for that application, or if it's a customer facing, you need to involve the customer. You need to take a sample from the population and try to see what is the expectation that they have and get that in. Second thing that we see a lot of time, technology is taken, technology decisions get taken with a very short-term view in mind. You have a pain area here and now, and you are trying to put money into it and take care of that pain area. You seldom look at the long-term strategy, maybe a 10-year strategy. Where is it that I want to be 10 years down the line? And is this technology going to take me there? Or can I invest slightly more in a technology which will not only take care of this, but over the next 10 years, take me from a position X to a position Y where I want to go? And the third area is the complete focus on change management. We see, though people talk about it, the actual, when the implementation gets done, the focus, the senior management time and governance which goes into the change management is very low. That is one of the reasons we see a lot of applications not getting adopted in an organization, or solutions not getting adopted.
Perfect. This says time's up, and it's got a big exclamation in front of me. Do I have time for a couple of questions? Yes. Two questions. Okay, there's one gentleman here. Please, can you get a mic here? Is anybody there with the mic, or has everybody run away?
Hello, check.
Yeah. And you may want to address it to the person whom you are asking the question, so we know.
Well, good afternoon. My name is Jayan Jain. I'm from Reliance Retail. Fantastic views, and really appreciate the kind of future thinking that you've shared with us. Just one question, and I think this is to the entire panel. We didn't hear anything at all about robotics and the role that it could have played in, say, mass customization. You're talking of personalization of services and products. Now, maybe if you look at it from a perspective of mass customization or mass personalization, would robotics and maybe 3D printing and these kind of technologies play any role? What do you think about it?
Absolutely, yes, it would. And when I was talking about mixed reality and the machine learning and artificial intelligence, it's a combination of that which will lead to robotics. And that's, again, happening many places in the world. In fact, I was recently in Saudi Arabia, where there was a robot which was welcoming the customers out there and being able to understand that. Yes, it would happen. And if you come back to the first thing which I said, the strategy is about how do you get the product and the people and the customers together with data and intelligence being in the core of it. That, along with mixed reality, is actually robotics. And that would happen for sure.
Very interesting. One more question. I think there's a lady here.
Hi, myself Prachi from Reliance Retail. So I have a question, like virtual reality. How, because the product, the actual product is different from what the virtual reality would be showing. So how actually the sales would be impacted for a retailer?
Oh no, the actual product, the virtual reality product will not be different from the actual reality product. And we can show you, we can demonstrate that to you in a HoloLens. To the extent, one of the main uses of HoloLens is actually in medical situations where they're looking at heart and exactly how to do an operation before even doing it. So there are situations where you can go, instead of, apart from the feel of it, you actually use the entire thing. You know, there are situations, I just saw an example that day, where somebody was about to buy a machine. This is a photocopy machine, and that's a massive investment, these not, right? And they use the photocopy machine, literally use the photocopy machine without it actually being there at all. And then they changed the version. I mean, they came to a different version of the photocopy machine and they used it. And eventually they said, oh, this one looks easier because I can operate it like this, I can open this particular door, I can use the buttons like this, and this is the one which I want. And they're made in such a way that it's absolutely as close to reality as possible.
So in apparels, if we talk of apparels, there would be different stitch, like the stitching is done by some normal common guy, and there are different sizes, different things. So virtual can show only what exactly, like the thing which it would show, but it can't show the actual product. Like there can be some differences always from what virtual reality would be there and what the actual product would actually be, like the stitching part or the anything like that, yeah.
Yeah, you will not be able to feel probably the texture of the product, but you will be able to see exactly how you will look yourself with that. And that's exactly what the augmented reality is about. It's about bringing that to life. Just think of this. You play a video game, right? You use Kinect and you play a video game. And how engrossed you get out there. Now, there is no boxer out there which is boxing. But you do perspire, the adrenaline comes in, and you almost are as if you're playing that game out there. And a good augmented reality solutions will get you to that level. That's what the technology is about.
Yeah, so...
Just one point on that one. So I think some of the retailers are primarily using something called, let's say, open change room. And they have this like cognitive mirror. So you could just go and pick up like a product of your choice, you scan it, and you're standing right in front of the mirror, and it gets virtually laid on you. And on the same time, you can also just do the mood setting and see that, like, what is the occasion? Is it going for the night out, or is it for the office, or whatever things? But equally important, while you choose this particular product, on the down below, it would primarily just show up, like, what are the matching accessories that can go well with that one. So you're not only talking about a virtual reality, you're also talking about a potential cross-sell and upsell opportunity. So whatever that happens on the online, which is now actually back into the stores.
So thank you. I think we ran out of time. There are lots more questions, I'm sure. These gentlemen are available for any question and answers outside of this room also. Big round of applause for the people who've been here.